Hey everybody, this is the first of three lectures about proposals. Today we're going to go over just the big picture, the overview, if you will, and we're going to talk about maps. If you need a refresher about what maps is, there was an audio lecture a week ago, and there is a PowerPoint by that title under Important Course Documents. So if you recall, for maps, M stands for mode, and mode essentially means what are the defining features or characteristics of a particular type of writing, okay? So the thing about technical writing, all technical writing, is actually that it should be clear, concise, and coherent, okay? Those are called the three C's. Now, if you Google it, you're gonna find that sometimes it's the four C's and they add in a fourth word that starts with C. I don't remember. I do the three. Clear, concise, and coherent. It's short and sweet, it's easily read and skimmable, and you say what you mean and you mean what you say. There's not a lot of fluff, okay? The other thing that's a characteristic of technical writing, specifically proposals, are that there are a great number of graphics or graphical elements. Sometimes graphics are actually pictures, sometimes they are tables, even a list can stand out from the page differently. One of the things that I run into a lot, especially if you're in engineering technology, one of those programs, is that you tend to think in pictures. And so the goal that we have in this class is to be able to put those pictures down on paper and then make sure that you explain with words what your brain already understands in pictures. So those graphics are really important. At times, graphics will be about 50%. It's not the case in this particular proposal, but that's something to keep in mind for the future. One of the other characteristics are that you use headings. And those offer a map of what is going on in the document. And I don't mean map as in maps, the acronym. I mean actually sort of directions. Instead of using transitions the way that you would in an English essay, where you finish one topic and then say some sort of transitionary word, moreover, something, something, in tech writing, it's much more efficient. It's clear, concise, and coherent. You slap a heading down and you shift gears automatically, and it's a much more precise and streamlined way of shifting between topics. Lastly, that you're going to have contents that cover introductions. You're going to need to have a set of objectives. You're going to have to talk about what the current situation or the problem is. You're going to have to explain what your proposed solution to that problem is, and then you're going to have to talk about your qualifications and a conclusion. And I'm going to go over each of those sections in more detail here in a moment. Okay, so you're going to do a reading this week from Johnson Sheehan online, and you'll see this graphic, very simple graphic again. The thing I want to point out here is that the size of each of those sort of boxes gives you an indication of how large the section should be or how much space that section should take up in an average proposal. So you'll notice that introduction is pretty slim, right? You just say, this is what I'm writing about. The current situation is there, but the project plan or the plan for how you're going to solve whatever problem you've posed is by far the largest. And then qualifications and then the end stuff is also fairly short. So the A of maps is audience. So who is it that you're writing to? Okay. Johnson Sheehan, again, will talk about primary, secondary, and tertiary readers. Primary are those that are directly related to the topic at hand. So for those of you who are in senior design, your senior design professor is going to be your primary reader. Also, if you have an industry contact that you're working with, let's say you're doing the project for a company, that would be a primary reader. A secondary reader are people who still have a vested interest in the document, and they may advise primary readers because they have expertise. And in that case, that would actually be me as your technical writing instructor. I have opinions, and sometimes I talk with your engineering profs about your work and that kind of thing. Other ones might also be people from industry that have sort of a vested interest, but maybe aren't your boss per se. So then lastly are tertiary readers. Those are people who may come across the document. That would be other students would be tertiary readers, maybe other professors that don't have any direct say in how the document is constructed or how it's perceived, but are going to be reading it. And just people you need to be aware of. So I actually just said all this. So if you want to go and look at the PowerPoint, you can read all of this a second time, but essentially it's what I said here. Okay. So P in MAP stands for purpose. So why is it that you were writing? Remember that saying to get a good grade isn't enough. The purpose for writing has to be directly correlated to the piece of writing itself. Okay. And so in a proposal, if you think about it, you're persuading. Okay. You're trying to gain approval to be able to continue the project. Okay. So the idea is that there's a problem to solve, or there is a need, or a current situation that is just not meeting someone's needs, right? You have a solution or a plan for how to address that. You have the qualifications and the abilities to manage a project to solve that issue, and that the costs of your solution outweigh are outweighed by the benefits, so that the efforts you're going to put in and the end result is cost effective more so than the existing situation. Okay, the last one for maps is situation. Situation basically is the context. These are things that impact the way that you write or what you write. Time is the major one, if you recall from the lecture before. When something is due in a hurry, you write it differently than when you have lots of time. Although most of you procrastinate, so it's kind of neither here nor there. So the situation here with proposals is specifically about the issue of solicited versus unsolicited proposals. In a solicited proposal, a customer or client is going to approach you with an existing problem. Okay, some of you have senior design projects probably that fit into this category. A company came to your senior design professor and said, "Hey, we've got this issue. Do you want to have your students work on it?" Okay, so an RFP is usually what's associated with that, a request for proposal. A lot of times, government contracts will be RFPs. You'll see defense industry coming out with, "Hey, we need something that fulfills this need." And then, if you work for a defense contractor such as Raytheon or any of the others, they will respond to it with a proposal of how they would solve the problem. An unsolicited proposal, you have to provide a lot more detail. You have to prove that there's a problem first, before you can say that you have a solution. So in the first example, you are handed the problem and you simply have to propose a solution. The second one, you have to first prove that there's a problem or a need, and then you provide your solution. So the next thing about situation is there are a couple different kinds of students in this class right now, because it's if it's a fall semester, there's going to be fewer students who are in senior design. If it's a spring semester, there's more likely to be more students who are in senior design. So depending on where you fall in the senior design spectrum, or maybe you're an English major, right, is going to change the way you write this proposal. Okay, so if you are currently in senior design, specifically phase two, if you're in CPET, WET, or ECT, if you are in just senior design for MET and IET, and essentially any of you who are currently in senior design, you're going to be doing what's called primary research. So you're going to write an unsolicited proposal. You have to convince the reader that there's a problem to be solved, right? And then you show the solution. And then your research is going to focus on designing, building, testing, and reporting about the creation of an actual thing. It has thinginess, it has physical attributes, or a service that you are creating, or other newly invented object, or that kind of thing, right? So that makes it primary. You are creating something that is new, right? Well, that's different than if you are not currently in senior design, or you are possibly in phase one of ECET, CPET, or WET. If you're an English major or others outside of engineering technology and you're taking the class, you would also have a secondary research project. Now, what that basically means is that you are going to need to propose an unsolicited proposal, right? You have to prove that there's a need, right? But that your project plan is probably going to focus more on doing secondary research, meaning looking for sources through the library and online, and compiling a report. This is much more like a research paper that you would do for any class. It just has to be on a technical topic and it has to be written in a technical way. All right. So that way there's a way for someone to take this class no matter what phase they're in of senior design or not senior design. Another issue, and I mentioned a little bit ago, time management is a crucial issue when it comes to the situation for any written document. Every student in this class is going to be impacted by time management. A lot of you have full-time jobs and you're in your last semester and you're tired. A lot of you have families. Most of you are going to have other classes and other responsibilities. And so you have to be able to manage your time effectively. I've set up the course so that it's week to week. I have small assignments. One a week just keeps you on task, right? I give you the calendar up front. You can work as far in advance as you'd like. But the key thing to think about is that you're facing a semester-long project. It is one project that is the duration of this entire semester. And you have to make sure that you set aside time on a regular basis to work on that project. Otherwise, you're going to be hit with deadline after deadline, and you're not going to know what to write about or to think about. One of the challenges of the course being online is that you are responsible even more than if you were in a face-to-face class with reminding yourself of when deadlines happen. Okay, again, I've made it as clear as I can on the website, but this comes down to you being able to manage a project. I mean, that's kind of one of the key features of senior design and project management, which is this class. But you have to be diligent on your own. So, other considerations to think about in terms of overview for the proposal. How long should it be is always the question. And I don't give page lengths. And my answer is almost always it depends, which is admittedly kind of annoying. I've had really good proposals that were 3 and 4 pages. I've had really good proposals that were 10 or 11. If you're currently enrolled in senior design, phase two, all right, you may revise the proposal that you did for phase one. Okay. I'd like to see it no more than 10 pages, and it needs to follow the formatting for this class. Remember, the purpose of this class is to help you communicate technical ideas to a broader audience outside of your specific field of engineering. And so you need to make sure that you adapt what you're saying in those other classes. If you turn in the exact same thing that you did in phase one, you're not going to get a very good score on it. So that's something to keep in mind. What should it include? In the next lecture, proposal lecture two, as it is aptly named, I'm going to go over each of the things, each of the different topics or contents that you should include. And then what are the deadlines and criteria? I'm going to talk about that in proposal lecture three. So, also in proposal lecture three, I'm going to go over some sample documents that I've collected from students over the years so that you can see sort of the range of possibilities for how this goes. It's a senior level class. There's lots of variation. Each of you is doing your own thing. And so, if you're ever in question, obviously you can email me and ask some questions. And that is all I have for you for proposal lecture number one. And I will be available as always through email, which is rumseys@ipfw.edu. Thanks very much.